Get your hands ready. Let's clap it out and let's welcome to the stage, the main stage, Sminu Jindal SAW. Come on, stand up.
Jane, Sminu, it's an honor and a privilege to be here sharing the stage with two of you, two powerhouse entrepreneur guys. Let's hear it for them. Jane Bianchini, Sminu Jindal. Now, Jane, Sminu, both of you have overcome so many challenges to get to where you are, both physically and figuratively. You're both female entrepreneurs in two very male-dominated spaces. Jane, what got you started out? We have the benefit of hindsight, 2020 today. Looking back, we know that you're a successful entrepreneur, but when you got started, what got you into that space and what was it like early on?
Yeah, thanks, Gaurav. Well, before I started my tech company, I had an IT recruitment firm. And sitting back and reflecting a little bit on the whole recruitment value chain, I noticed that there was one piece of this value chain that was yet to be innovated, and that was the phone screen stage of a recruitment process. And so I thought I had the unicorn idea by creating video interviewing. It turned out there were a couple of other people globally that were also doing it. So I wasn't first, but certainly pioneered in the space. So it was sheer blind faith, really, and the entrepreneurial optimism that got me into the business. Well, how hard could it be, right? I don't know anything about tech. I recruit them. I don't know what they do. But so, I went about just starting from the beginning. I sketched out a business requirements document. I then went and hired a business analyst to flesh out some of those ideas. One of the more good luck and fortune than by planning, I hired a UX UI designer very, very early on to try and translate some of my crazy, kooky ideas into images to then be able to communicate with the engineers. So the journey kind of continued, but I still had my recruitment company, and I was kind of feel like I was cheating on my recruitment company when I was spending time building up the software business and vice versa. And I was really struggling with having these two businesses and divided focus. And for those of you who saw Tyra Banks, you know, leave them first before they leave you, I kind of fell out of love with my recruitment business because I was so passionate about how I was materially changing the landscape of the recruitment industry. And so I was having this conversation with one of my mentors, and he said, Jane, you've got a shoe and two canoes, so pick one. So it was a pretty easy choice for me, although very, very difficult in the execution of that. So it was the recruitment business that had kept the funding of the video interviewing business alive, and that dried up. So I realized I had to get some funding. So went through two rounds of capital raising, which was, again, an interesting journey as a non-tech, tech, sole founder, female, being asked very different sets of questions than my male counterparts were being asked. My male counterparts were being asked questions that were very much aspirational. How are you going to blitz scale the business? How are you going to take over the world? Whereas questions I were being asked, I was being asked questions like, well, how are you going to protect the downside, and what are you going to do about minimizing risk, and how are you going to protect my investment, and how are you not going to go and spend all the money? It's like, wow. So as soon as I started to answer in the positive, when I was getting a negative question, I started to raise the money. So the journey kind of continued on from there, and COVID hit. And that was actually very kind to me, being a video interviewing business. And before COVID, it was very much a change and transformation sell. And then, of course, COVID hit and everyone wanted video interviewing. It hit the hockey stick curve and was going up, and I caught the eye of a US private equity firm who knocked on my door and made me an offer. I said, well, it's pretty difficult to buy something that's not for sale. And private equity went, everyone's for sale, and all right. They put an offer to me. I ran back to my EO SaaS forum and said, oh my God, what do I do? They said, girl never accepts the first offer. I didn't accept the first offer. Make me another offer. So they did. So I made the transition and sold. That was my first rodeo. So then had a rock star lawyer who negotiated a 9-month earnout, which was just amazing. So successfully completed that in December. And unusually, I've stayed on with that organization and hoping to see the next sale through to completion. And then I think that will probably be the end of this entrepreneurial journey for me.
You know, it's funny you say it was the easy choice to leave the recruitment business and move into this, but I'd like to just enumerate, you were a sole tech founder. And by the way, the statistics say you're better off with 2 or 3 co-founders and not just one. You were female in an underrepresented space, and you didn't come from a tech background. So when I hear you say it was an easy choice,
just entrepreneurial optimism, right?
Right. As you said, blind optimism.
Yeah.
Sminu, what about you? You come from a family of literally nation builders. Your family's name is synonymous with the country of India, universities, politics, steel, energy. Literally everything that's about the country is synonymous with your family. What was it like for you to create a space for yourself with such large shadows around you?
Now, I guess it's very easy to actually grow up with legends and not realize what you're actually learning at the dining table every day. For me, it was no different. I just had stalwarts around me. And I guess from childhood, I wanted to be in the business of oil, gas, and steel. I liked how my father did work every day. I liked, it attracted me how he works every day. And I only imagine myself being an entrepreneur, although I do come from a family where women really didn't work as much. And it was a very traditional joint family business. I would be the first woman who actually had decided to work in my dad's company. So from that angle, I did break rules a lot.
And what are some of the early challenges that you faced when you made that space for yourself?
Actually, I always wanted to be a woman entrepreneur. I was 11 years old when I met with a car accident. My driver was drunk. So a message to all the young people out there, please don't drink and drive and do wear your seatbelt. I wasn't doing either of them. And I think that really worked in my favor because as life went on, I decided there is much more to me than just my legs. And I realized that if it wasn't for my accident, I probably wouldn't have the opportunity of standing on my own 2 feet like the rest of the family did. So for me, that was an opportunity that actually catapulted me forward to chase my dreams.
And one of the things as a coach, when I'm coaching some of my clients, what I've seen is that even Jim Quick spoke about this. One of the most important things is our BS, right? Our belief systems. As entrepreneurs who've overcome so much to get to where you are, what are some of the strongest beliefs that you hold about yourself, Sminu?
I really believe in the power of believing in oneself. The fear lies within us. And that's what stops us from achieving what we were really born to do. Resilience is a quality which is underestimated, and kindness is something which is missing. I hope to bring kindness on table.
Jane, what about you? What are some of the defining qualities and characteristics about yourself that you feel have gotten to where you are today?
I think probably three things, actually. One would be just sheer grit. one of the things they say is businesses fail when the founder gives up, just never gave up. The second is just my thirst for knowledge and curiosity. I've got just a very curious mind and appetite, so I think that probably pushed me through the learning curve to really get to the bottom of but why. And integrity. And I think, after my first capital raise, I made some mistakes and spent all the money and had got the strategy wrong and went back to the same shareholders and said, I've spent all the money and I've got the strategy wrong, but I know what I need to do to pivot to get to back on track. And they just sat there dumbfounded in disbelief going, none of our founders are ever this honest. So because of your openness and honesty and integrity, not trying to, sugarcoat it, and they all came back around into the second round. So, yeah. So it's probably those three things.
That's right. A wonderful, wonderful achievement. Wonderful achievement.
So you both have these defining characteristics about yourself. What are some of the things that you use these as fuel to overcome? What are those defining moments, those inflection points that have really, made your careers what they are today?
I'm sorry, I didn't quite get you.
So you mentioned resilience. Right. Jane was speaking about grit, curiosity, integrity. What is it that has allowed, what is it about these characters that has allowed you to overcome challenges, and what are those defining moments that have underscored those personalities?
There have been many challenges. I think it comes with being a woman on a wheelchair. People think I really don't know what I'm talking about. Being born in a business family where everybody knew what to do in the workspace, especially at the plants that we run, and technical aspects they think is something that eluded me, but it didn't. There was a time period where I'd gone for a plant visit, and I was with my manager. Let's call him Dan, because we don't want to name anybody. So he went with me, and I said, the guy's welding the wrong way, Dan. He said, no, Ms. Jindal, he's doing just fine. I said, well, I think he's got his oxygen opened a little bit too much, and he doesn't know where he's really welding. And he said, no, Ms. Jindal, I think he's doing fine. I said, please, just if you could just go and take a look and just ask him. Then he comes back with a sheepish grin saying that, Ms. Jindal, you were right. He was not welding the right way. So there are many such obstacles that come our way. And it just made me want to stick on longer. The first day I joined work, there were 7 HODs that resigned immediately because they didn't want to report to a boss that was playing with them a few years back. They saw me grow up. And the furnaces broke down. So what I had to do, I had to do. I had to read up all night to make sure that I know how do I talk the language of refractory lining, the bricks, and et cetera, et cetera. But finally got there. So every time there's a challenge, I just want to push myself a little bit harder. And it's that ability to be able to overcome that I'm sitting right amongst all of you and feeling so honored and proud of myself.
Yeah, very much so.
One would think that coming from such a strong heritage as yourself, Sminu, you wouldn't have to face such challenges. But, Tyra Banks spoke about it as well yesterday. As a woman, do you feel that you have to constantly prove yourself? You spoke about resilience and grit. You have that within yourself. When do you feel the work is done of making others around you and your organization also understand that?
The work is never done because I've never really realized what is all within me. So if I haven't realized completely what's inside of me, I don't expect anybody else to really get there before me. And that's the whole challenge.
Right. Jane, you also spoke about something similar about how men in your industry are being asked different questions when they're raising capital, whereas females are being asked a completely different set of questions.
Yeah.
Did you ever feel that yes, I have arrived now, and that I am being treated on the same platform and equally as my male counterparts?
I think once I worked the game out, I felt I had more control. Yeah. So, again, just you know, as Sminu was talking, just dogged self-belief, and just, you know, we were laughing earlier when we were saying there is no plan B.
There is no plan B.
There's only plan A. So, yeah, this has to work. But
yeah, isn't it surprising how we really actually depend on plan A? There are lots of people who tell me, "What's your plan B?" And I'm like, "I never have a plan B. If plan A fails, I'm miserable. It just can't."
But it was exactly right. But, like, even my partner at the beginning of the journey said to me, "Look, honey, I think you better stop this hobby of yours and focus on the recruitment business." And of course, I sell. And how's this hobby going for you, huh?
So worked out well, all right, in the end.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So of course, now my children are like, "Well, when's mum going to have another hobby?" Yeah.
So what about being a female managing, you know, so many different things, juggling so many different things? What has been the biggest challenge for you, Jane, in this entire journey?
The biggest challenge, gosh. to be honest with you, every hour was either champagne or razor blades. the entrepreneurial journey is not a straight line. It's a bee dance. And I've had many opportunities and setbacks for sure. And you know, one of the biggest ones, the biggest challenge is there any non-tech founders in the audience? See if there are any. Yeah, a couple, right? So this is good. Just as a health warning, this is going to give you anxiety, right? So I'm literally just about to raise the first round of capital, and money was coming in. The day before, I'm in a meeting with my lawyers and my main investor, my taxation accountant, working out how I'm going to give 10% of the company to my tech director. He rings me as I'm walking into the meeting, and he resigns. And there is nothing I can do to convince him. He had good reasons as to why he didn't want to continue the journey, and just sitting in this three-hour meeting, how are we going to carve up 10% and restructure the company for this guy? And it's like, and of course, I'd sold this how amazing he was to all the investors. So given my recruitment background, I the next morning got up at 4 o'clock and just doubled down on trying to replace him. Of course, I'd selected the wrong, not the wrong, a programming language that was very niche, so the skills weren't really available. But yeah, I had to go back around to all the investors and go, "So, you know how I'm not technical? Well, we don't actually have a tech director anymore."
Unenviable place to be.
It was just, you know, I just was sitting in front of these investors just wanting to cry, going, "They're just going to withdraw their money and it's all going to be up before I even started." And they said, "No, Jane, it's you. You know, you're the product visionary. You're the one that has the ideas. You're the one that has a deep connection to the problem. We just need to replace him, but we need to replace him now." So off I go.
It's always the entrepreneur, as you said.
Well, just to distract it from all this, I think my biggest challenge currently is to convince my children their mom made it. You know, as a mom,
yeah.
I think that's a challenge. And yeah, one of my child is sitting right amongst all of you.
Yeah.
So, hey, Anav.
Sminu, you've taken on so many challenges in your life. Sminu's very humble, but she's done a lot of things in her life. Apart from the accident that she's been through, she's taken on an international airline because they were not being equitable and treating people with disabilities equally. She's made monuments in India accessible. You've done so many things. What out of all of these was the most difficult for you?
I think life. Life is most difficult for all of us. It's honestly not comparing about our journey with somebody else. Mine isn't as tougher than anyone else of tougher than anyone's, because each one of us knows only that set of problem. And when we overcome a problem, we feel like winners. It seems that mine seems harder, but that's all that I was served. Either I play with this and make it bigger, or I just sit down and sulk. I decided to move ahead, just like any one of you when you are faced with a problem. Accessibility is very, very deep in my heart. It strikes a very deep chord in my soul because accessibility is very misunderstood. It's a concept that is currently linked with disability. Disability is a problem. Accessibility is a solution. Accessibility affects each one of us as we go through reduced mobility phases in our life of growth. When we are kids, we are unable to reach the wash basin on our own. When we are adults, we've got arthritis in our knees, we may not be able to climb stairs. And that's what civilization is all about. That's why we discovered the wheel, because we could go from one place to another with ease, comfort, and dignity. And that's what accessibility is. To me, accessibility, in simple words, is reaching your place of destination with ease and safety. Wow. And for that, we must talk about accessibility etiquettes. In US, accessibility is pretty much there. It's still lacking in the washroom sometimes, but mostly it's there. But the rest of the world, especially the developing nations, and the opportunity that surrounds accessibility is immense. And as entrepreneurs that are sitting in this hall with all of us, it's a big business opportunity, honestly, to think about the access requirements, especially that exist in the third world countries. We are talking about a $1 trillion economy waiting right there to happen. We're waiting for young minds like all of you to think about it differently and to actually give it to the people, because we will grow older. The longevity of life has, and the medical advances have made it happen that we easily live up to 80, 90. Maybe some of us will see 100 years of life. And in that journey, when we have reduced mobility, accessibility is going to be the only flicker of hope that helps us carry on. Somebody asked me whether accessibility is expensive or not. I want each one of us to probably look at our grandparents, our friends, pregnant women, children with broken bones, athletes that go ahead and dislocate their knee trying to win a medal for their country. Accessibility is hope. Hope is priceless. It's worth for all of us to look into it and to make it happen. Because today, we will be making it happen for our own future, for our own growth.
So true, so true.
So that's my passion, Svayam.
I think, Sminu, you brought up two really good points. The first is that there is no hierarchy of suffering. Everybody has their own flavor of difficult, own flavor of challenges to deal with. Just because someone looks something externally doesn't make someone else's challenges any less difficult to deal with. So I think that's a great point that you raised. And the second is that accessibility isn't just for one small sub-segment of people. We all are temporarily require accessibility at some point, whether it's old age, whether it's when we're pregnant, whether it's when a loved one passes away and we're not able to think clearly. We all need some support at some period of our life or the other. In fact, I was reading a really good book the other day called Who, Not How. And oftentimes, as entrepreneurs, we're always thinking about how am I going to get over this next challenge. But sometimes we also need to think about who is it in my community or in my network that's going to help me to overcome this next barrier. Jane, I know that you've been able to do this really well. You've tapped your community and you've really figured out who is it in your network that can help you. Could you speak to that a little bit?
This is my community. EO is my community. I relied very heavily on mentors, and I got the benefit of learning about mentorship by sitting on the EO Sydney board as mentorship chair. And if anyone here hasn't yet had a mentor through EO, it's life-changing. It is categorically life-changing. But just a quick sidebar comment: if you do have a mentor, or if you get one in the future, make sure that you prepare to an inch of your life for that meeting that you have with them, because their time is worth, in some cases, thousands and thousands of dollars, and you're getting some really good quality advice for that time that you have with them. But yeah, I've had four mentors through EO. My first one basically grabbed me and said, you need to slow the flock down, calm your farm, The second one, he basically said, you are absolutely crap at managing tech people. Get rid of them, outsource it, go and learn how to manage them and insource it back, but protect your IP. Okay. My third was the most significant, where he had asked me to complete Robin Sharma's 8 Forms of Wealth, a spreadsheet. And I realized that all road led to me wanting needing to capital raise. And so he introduced me to his heli skiing buddies, of course, right? And that started the process for me raising money. At which point his heli skiing buddy said to him, do you actually know what she's doing? And he went, oh, no, I don't actually. So he came and had a look at what I was building, and he actually then became my largest shareholder and chairman. Of course, the mentorship relationship ended, which was the right thing to do. And then my final mentor, a unicorn in Australia, coached me through the sale of the company. So, but even reaching out to the EO past and present Facebook group, going, has anyone sold their company? Did they regret it? You know, and everyone just came back piling on fabulous experiences and never regretting it. So, yeah, and of course, my EO SaaS forum in Sydney as well were a very big support. So.
Yeah.
So, you know, Jane, a lot of us find it difficult just to even have one mentor. You've done it 4 times over, right?
Yeah. And I'm glutton for punishment.
And as you mentioned, oftentimes their time is worth thousands and thousands of dollars. How did you go about convincing them, again, as a non-tech, sole tech founder, how did you even go about convincing them that, hey, look, I'm the right horse to bet on. You should spend your time mentoring me. If you could just share with us, you know, what does that process look like?
I just thought they thought I was just crazy. And I think it was more intrigue than anything else. But to be honest with you, I had such a deep passion about this. I think this was infectious and rubbed off on them. And I think, but also turning up, being prepared, making it easy. And I too didn't really understand why they were going on this journey with me until I started mentoring myself. And the value you get back from giving, the gift is in the giving, right? So they all, and it's time bound, right? So the EO mentorship is just 12 months, and you set the celebratory lunch or dinner at the beginning of the relationship. And so they all, you know, thanked me for the journey, and also, you know, my first mentor, he was, he's currently now the CEO of Sprint here in the US, and for him it was getting connected back in with that entrepreneurial spark and the flair and the champagne and razor blade moments that I think is what they really enjoyed, the pace and the journey.
Right. Sminu, what about you? You've had so many people just within your family and outside who've been there to shape your career and to really be a guiding force. Who are those people for you, not just in business, but even in life, given your unique circumstances, that have helped you to shape your career so far?
I like to learn from every person that I come across. I've learned how to smile and talk like Jane does. And I think growing up with such wonderful entrepreneurs all around me was a big teacher for me. My grandmom, she was a great entrepreneur, if one may say so, because my grandfather would just bring 40 people over for dinner without telling her in advance. So, you know, she would go in the kitchen and she'd make a meal, and I would be like, wow, this is better than McDonald's being served instantly, 5 dishes, you know, like that. So that requires a lot of gut, a lot of entrepreneurial spirit to be able to cook from nothing. I had my uncle, Naveen Jindal. He's an amazing polo player. He also shoots. He runs the largest company. He was a politician who was elected twice. For me, he is like this Superman who, whatever he touches, he's the man with the Midas touch. One of my uncles who runs Jindal Southwest is a very, very big player in India today in steel as well as in energy, in cement. I've got like successful people all around me, so much so that they make it feel like it's so easy in life to actually win if one concentrates on doing what they find is best. My own dad. The thing is that he was able to look beyond me just as being a girl and to give me an opportunity to work with him. I'll forever be grateful to him. My grandfather, of course, I truly cherish him because he supported me as a child into doing whatever I could. So it was amazing being really growing up with all these people and learning entrepreneurial spirit in more ways than just seeing a boardroom and dealing with boardroom tactics. So
incredible.
And post the accident, you said, how was that experience for you? How was your community and people around you able to rally around you and really get to where you are today?
Luckily, my community around me is my friends and my family. They helped me realize and reach my potential. Like today's theme is the convention's theme is unleash. They helped me unleash. And when I'm here sharing my thoughts, sharing my journey, about being fearless, about believing in yourself, about achieving what you have set down to achieve, is something that I hope would help unleash many more million and their potential going forward.
Jane, what about yourself? Going forward, what do you think is the, you know, in EO we have one of the values as make a mark. What is a mark that you'd like to leave with your company and your legacy as an entrepreneur?
So let me share some statistics with you, which is what really fires me up. So of tech companies, only 30% are female founded. Female founders return on average 10% more cumulative revenue over 5 years than their male counterparts. A VC called First Round Capital looked back over 10 years and compared female-founded businesses with male-founded businesses, and they found that female businesses perform 63% better than their male counterparts. These figures will only improve for women over 40. yet only 2% of VC funding goes to women.
Really?
Only 2%. It's hard to believe. So I guess what I'm really wanting to do is encourage both sides of the spectrum, the people who are generous with their money and also their funds that they are managing, and also females to really give it a red hot shot because it can be done. So I really want to try and improve those numbers, but also knowing that I had so much support coming through my journey, particularly through EO, it's giving back in mentorship as well and teaching others how to structure a mentor relationship really, you know, aim for the stars.
If both of you were back on this stage in 10 years' time at GLC 2032, what would you have liked to achieve by then?
Oh, my God.
That's a tough question. So much. So it's 10 years is a long time, and I know.
Oh, it goes by so fast.
You're right. The days are long, but the years are short.
Yeah, right? I agree with you. I think I would love to have gone forward with accessibility. Improve my business, yes. Took better care of my family, see them read somewhere. Make the world a better place than what I really inherited as.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Make the world a better place.
Definitely. Just to inspire more more people to become
and
entrepreneurs.
And more women.
And more women, yes.
Yes,
exactly.
And more women.
But entrepreneurs, we define the future, we create jobs, we give back to our communities, so really wanting to inspire more people to take this journey. For sure. But yeah, and then personally, maybe also try my hand at a different industry. So, yeah.
And more years for abilities.
And yes. More, absolutely.
I know Twitter is now being taken over by a certain gentleman, but if you had the ability to tweet a piece of advice to everyone in the audience right now, what would that piece of advice be, especially young people facing challenges in their businesses, looking to overcome them, replicate some of your success? What would that tweet say?
I would just say, believe in yourself. Fear is all what is there in our mind. take a step forward, because there are many more like us who are more afraid and therefore chained. When we become brave, we make life move forward. Just believe in yourself. It's possible.
Mm. Wow. Beautiful.
Yeah, that's great.
Thank you.
Yeah, and I think, don't give up. That lovely saying, it'll be all right in the end, and if it's not all right, it's not the end. So keep going.
Great.
Well said.
Perfect. Thank you so much, guys. Let's hear it for Sminu Jindal, Jane Biancini. Hope to see you back at GLC 2032. Hope you've achieved everything that you wish to. And it's been an honor sharing the stage with both of you and hearing about your journeys. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you for having us over.
Yes.
Thank you so much for having us over.